Well, good morning or good afternoon or good evening, friends, depending on where you are. This is Casey Gwinn, the president of Alliance for Hope International, and we're very honored to have you all joining us today for this webinar. We have folks from all over the United States, and we have some attendees from other countries around the world. So it's a great honor to have you with us today. As we get started, just a few business matters. This recording is going to be available after the webinar on familyjusticecenter.com or .org. Riley Shore, who's running our webinar today, will be downloading this and then making it available within 24 to 48 hours. You will receive a certificate of attendance after the webinar, along with a survey. And during this webinar, we will be providing an opportunity in the questions bar, the chat bar, for you to make comments or to ask questions, and we will be taking the questions at the end of the broadcast. The topic today is confidentiality and information sharing in family justice centers. I'm very honored to have Meg Garvin joining me today for this webinar, and we will be introducing Meg in just a few minutes. We have about 1,000 people registered for this webinar today, and so we will not be able to have people speak. Everyone is muted on this call, but you do have the opportunity to post questions and to make comments in the chat, and we will, of course, make those available afterwards. All of that will also be available in the downloaded webinar recording that will be available to you. And we hope that this will be a webinar that can be used as a resource in the weeks and months to come as we talk about these issues and address these issues in family justice and multi-agency centers working with victims of violence and abuse across the country and around the world. The webinar today is sponsored by the Office on Violence Against Women of the U.S. Department of Justice. The acting director of OVW is Laura Rogers. Kevin Sweeney is our program manager at OVW, and we so appreciate Kevin and his support over the years for our work. We serve as the technical assistance provider for family justice and other multi-agency sector collaboratives and kind of co-located approaches. And we also provide support for their work around strangulation. We run the Training Institute on Strangulation Prevention. You see Gail Strack, our CEO, in that picture there with Kevin, and Gail oversees our Training Institute on Strangulation Prevention, which is a fee-for-service program and is also the technical assistance provider for OVW grantees across the United States. We don't do a webinar, most of you know, without giving a shout out to our team at Alliance for Hope International. It's a team that has really worked hard to stick together during this pandemic and to support each other. And it's a team that means the world to us as we navigate such difficult times personally and professionally. So we always like to recognize everybody from Gail Strack, our CEO, throughout everybody else on our team. You'll see down in the bottom right, an interim member of our team, Susan Williams, who's the former deputy director of OVC and former associate director at OVW as well. Who has now joined our team for the short term to help us in some transition times. We're very honored to have Susan on our team as well. You'll also see Rayanne Passantino just above Susan. Rayanne is the assistant director of our Family Justice Center programs, and she and Susan are overseeing all the work we do around family justice centers, including webinars like this. We do want to announce as we get started that we have just been in consultation with OVW, and our conference is not going to be able to be hosted in person in San Diego. We've been saying for the last couple of months we had to move our conference from May to September, and we've been saying we will have it in San Diego or we will have it in your living room, one of the two, but we're not canceling. And after hearing from OVW this week, we are going to have it in your living room. So the conference will be happening those dates, September 9 to 11. We are building an online platform right now called the Hope Hub Online Learning Academy. We're going to be using Vimeo for our live broadcasting, Vimeo Premium, and we're wireframing that into our website and connecting it to our resource library as we speak. And so we will look forward to all of you that may already be registered for our conference or plan to register. We'll be putting up a post about that shortly on our website. But today our focus is confidentiality and information sharing, a challenge at any time, and certainly even now, a significant challenge during COVID-19, and a lot of our family justice centers working virtually, a lot of community-based sexual assault and domestic violence agencies having to do virtual advocacy and online advocacy. And so it's a really timely conversation to have. And we're very honored, as I said, to have Meg Garvin joining us today. Meg is the executive director of the National Crime Victim Law Institute. NCVLI is how we usually refer to it. She's also a professor at Lewis and Clark School of Law. Meg is without a doubt one of the leading kind of legal experts and thinkers on victims' rights around the United States. She's testified in Congress and state legislatures, obviously in judicial proceedings. She's done a lot of work with the military over the years. She's been part of the Victims Advisory Group for the U.S. Sentencing Commission, and she's done a lot of work with the American Bar Association as well. And in her work over the years, without a doubt, she has earned incredible respect from us and from all those that have worked with her across the country. She's been with NCVLI since 2003 as their executive director. And so we're so honored to have Meg with us today. I'll be turning it over to Meg in just a moment. Meg's going to present for about 30 minutes, kind of take the big picture overview of confidentiality and privilege and privacy, and then I'll be talking a little bit about the application of those principles in family justice centers, and then we'll dialogue a little bit and take your questions and answers. So Meg, it's great to have you with us today. Thanks for joining us. I'm going to hand you the keyboard and give you control over the mouse and take it away.
Thank you so much, Casey. I am really glad to be here and excited to have so many people joining us today, and then also for the recording after. Just a little bit about NCVLI, and Casey, just so you all know, it's not advancing for me, so I don't yet have control of the keyboard. Just a little bit about NCVLI and the approach that I'm gonna be taking. We only have an hour and a half total to talk to each other today, which when it comes to privacy, confidentiality, and privilege is not a lot of time. And so what I'm gonna do is try and share some principles with everybody. And then Casey, as he noted, is gonna do some as applied work on it. I wanna note that these are hard subjects, and it is okay. And in fact, I would say from NCVLI's perspective, encouraged to debate them. The idea that we can, in one fell swoop, in 30 minutes, reach agreement on what privacy, confidentiality, and privilege mean in every moment is not accurate, and in fact is not ideal. So I'm gonna share some principles, Casey's gonna share some things, and then we are gonna dialogue about it, because the key here is everyone on this line, hopefully, I don't know all of you personally, but hopefully everyone is on the line to ensure safe spaces for survivors. And so debating how do we do that? How do we structure things? How do we create systems and processes that enhance survivor choice and voice? That's our goal, and that takes conversation and dialogue. So I'm excited. A little bit about NCVLI, because I think it's really important that folks know the lens through which speakers see the world. So I, as Casey noted, I've been with NCVLI since 2003. NCVLI is a legal nonprofit, meaning our focus is on the law. We work on survivor-centered legal advocacy. We work all over the country, and we were founded to kind of fill a niche. We were founded because in criminal justice, even if everyone just, you know, I can't see you, but in your, close your eyes and in your mind's eye, picture a criminal courtroom for a second, right? If everyone would actually engage me with this and focus predominantly on domestic criminal justice, but I know there's some international folks on the line, and many common law countries are designed exactly the same way. If you close your eyes and you picture the criminal courtroom, most of us will picture the judge up front and then two tables, right? And those tables represent, generally speaking, the prosecutor and the defense. And yet it is a human being, the victim, about whom the case is evolving, right? It's them. And so NCVLI was founded on the idea of What would happen in criminal justice if a survivor had his or their own attorney to protect their rights, including their rights to privacy? Not to take over prosecution, not to change that structure, but to say, you know what, there's a human being in this mix and their voice matters. So NCVLI was founded, and one of our founding principles is a punctuation mark, essentially. We are aimed at, and our mission is all about victims' rights. And the punctuation that matters to us is the apostrophe. Victim apostrophe S rights, or victims plural apostrophe rights. Apostrophes in the English language denote ownership. They can be a contraction, obviously, but not in this situation. Right? Ownership. Our founding principle is survivors own their rights. So how do we as service providers ensure that punctuation has meaning in our systems, in our processes? Privacy, confidentiality, and privilege are key to this discussion. So I'm going to discuss a little bit about the concept of privacy as well as the law of privacy, obligations of confidentiality, and then a little bit about the difference between confidentiality and privilege, all while we're thinking about what are the considerations of protecting survivor agency as they access services in family justice centers. I'm gonna come back to the term agency later, but I want folks to just put a mental footnote right there. Like, why did Meg use the term agency? So often we hear the word autonomy, right? I'm gonna come back to that later, but it's intentional. And it's intentional around this entire conversation. So, one of my amazing colleagues at the National Crime Victim Law Institute a few years ago wrote a policy paper, what we call a legal bulletin, and it's available on our website, talking about privacy, confidentiality, and privilege. And she came up with this wonderful visual for it, and her name is Terry Campos. And she came up with this wonderful visual of thinking about privacy, confidentiality, and privilege as a closet. And many of us who are privileged enough to have a closet, I do not have one that looks like the one that's on the screen that is that large, but many of us will have a closet in our homes, right? And so when you start to think about privacy, confidentiality, and privilege, it's the first step is, did you invite someone into your home at all, right? And then you have a closet and you put stuff in it, right? But generally speaking, for most of us, we do not have a lock on our closets, but we might have stuff in our closet. You know, my closet's pretty private, like, because I throw stuff in there. I don't want everyone to see it. When company comes over, I shut the door, but I don't lock my privacy closet, right? I don't lock that. Inside it, there will be things that maybe I lock. Maybe I have a safe in it. Maybe I have something else in it, right? That's when we start to get to confidentiality and privilege. So I just want us to be thinking, like, I invite someone into my home. That's already, I've let down some of my privacy protection. But I have a closet, I keep the door closed, generally speaking, but I don't lock it, right? And then we'll move on to confidentiality and privilege in just a little bit. So in my privacy closet, in my closets, I keep some things that I don't want everyone to know, right? And then within that, I might have things that are in, on the visual, you'll see like a suitcase that can close again, but maybe I've shared the key with someone. That's confidentiality. And then privilege is the thing where I just don't give anybody the darn key, right? So there's a closet, has a door, but you can get into it, generally speaking. There's confidentiality, where I let people in by giving them and sharing with them a key, but I still keep a key. I can take it back. And then there's privilege, where I'm like, you never get my key, right? That's the privacy closet. And we're going to unpack just a little bit this visual. And again, we've written about this on our website. And so you can access more information there. But when we think about privacy, many of us, and I'm going to actually encourage folks to use the chat box now, because I think it's good for our brains as we are learning and thinking about things, even through technology, to be exercising different parts of our brain. So in the chat box, start typing, what do you think of when the question is posed to you, what is privacy, right? Just go ahead and chat. You know, there's lots of quotes out there about what it is, right? It's the right to be let alone. Oh, okay. It's it requires having a sense of control, power and control over one's story, over one's information, all of that. It's the quality or state or condition of being free from public attention, right? We all have different definitions of privacy. The question, though, is what does it mean in law? And then we'll get to why is it important. So in law, if anyone can use the chat box, just start thinking, where does the right to privacy come from? Right? Just think about it for a second. Where is it in law? And I know there may be some lawyer. I know for a fact there's some lawyers on the phone. I know that there are advocates on the phone. I know there are other allied professionals on the phone and on the internet with us. But really pause to think about it, because too often we throw out the word privacy, but we don't think about the fact that it is, in fact, a legal right. It is embedded in our U.S. Constitution that every person has a right to privacy. The lawyers on the phone know that it, you know, it's this odd, wacky kind of history of case law that led to this right to privacy, but it's there, and we have it. And then every state in this country has statutes governing victims' rights, most of which have something embedded in with them about privacy. Sometimes it's stated as dignity, fairness, and respect for privacy. Others have a standalone right to privacy. Some states have a standalone constitutional right to privacy, not just for survivors, not just for victims, just for their whole population. Then we have statutes, right? So we have state constitutions, we have the federal constitution, we have state statutes, all of which have privacy protections in them. Why is it so important, right? Why have we structured a society that says you get to keep things to yourself? And this is really important to think about, because we were founded, you know, there was the colonization, right? There were, of course, many, many cultures in North America before we were colonized. Our current legal system, though, is structured post-colonization, right? It was structured on those who colonized us, right? In that system of colonization and then becoming the United States, structurally, we built a society that says privacy matters. The government and even your neighbor do not get access to everything about you, right? And it is there because we wanted to have individual rights. We wanted to have ownership, right, over those things. And if we take all of that and apply it to survivors, you start to think about why is privacy important? It matters to survivors. And there's this just amazing quote from 2005 that we deploy all the time. And I mean, I love it so much. For many victims, privacy is like oxygen. It's a pervasive, consistent need at every step of recovery. Within the context of the legal system, if you lose privacy, other remedies are moot. This is foundational for how NCVLI approaches these issues. If I lose my privacy without it being a choice, right? Go back to the privacy closet. I can invite you in my home, right? Oh, I've already now given you something, right? But I chose that. I invited you in. Oh, you know what? I'm going to show you my ridiculously messy closet, right? I don't know how many of you have one. I have one. And every now and then I do share it with a friend. I'm like, oh my gosh, come in here, look at it. Ah, I chose again, right? I chose to share that with you. As we're moving from victim to survivor to thriver, that choice matters a ton. And it matters a ton because there is the trauma from the original incident, and then there is trauma that can happen along the way. And if we really think about definitions of trauma, and I could recite, well, I'd have to pull it, I have it open. I could read to you DSM's definition, but fundamentally, right, trauma, and I often draw from Dr. Chris Wilson's discussions about trauma and the neurobiology of trauma to kind of find ways of talking about it that apply to my daily practice. And this is one that he articulates a lot, right? It is the notion of extreme threat, terror, and horror plus loss or perceived loss of control equals trauma. Loss or perceived loss of control. And that equals a traumatic moment. Trauma happens in the moment of victimization, right? Hopefully we all know that. Hopefully we all have taken some neurobiology of trauma trainings to understand what happens in that moment and what happens afterwards. Because what we also know is that when a survivor loses control over their story, real or perceived, meaning I don't open the door to my closet for you, you barge in, law enforcement, prosecution, whoever, right? You barge in and look in my closet, or you, when we get to confidentiality and privilege, you go into the suitcase or you go into the lockbox, that causes a different trauma. And so when we're thinking about privacy, privilege, confidentiality, it is incredibly important to put it all in context. These are not minor moments as we set up our family justice centers and as we think about processes. They are fundamental both to the way we structured our society to honor privacy and to survivors moving towards resilience, right? So one of the keys that NCVLI has to work with a lot is, and when we're working with multidisciplinary teams, community, coordinating community responses, anytime we're starting to have multidisciplinary approaches to things, we always want folks thinking about all of these aspects, including some very important things about understanding prosecutors and criminal justice. Because too often we aren't kind of noting victims' rights, that they're the law, and understanding and differentiating prosecutors' role, right? So prosecutors have, and I'm gonna dig into this just a little bit because it, right on this slide, it talks about prosecutors' role, and I just did air quotes around that, but no one could see me. But it's actually the state's role in many ways, right? During criminal justice, and when our survivors actually have to navigate criminal justice by choice or not choice, obviously the first moment is never choice, but sometimes they want to engage in criminal justice, other times they do not. Once that process starts going, there are obligations of the state or the prosecutor to share information with the defense, all grounded in the idea that in criminal trial in particular, it should never be a surprise trial, right? You shouldn't have surprises in criminal justice. That's the theory of our criminal justice system. What that translates into for all of us that are service providers at the front end, whether you're an advocate, whether you're a lawyer, whether you're a first responder, when you're on that front end, what it translates into is because the prosecution has these duties later, we need to always know who is under the state's possession or control. This is called Brady, right? There is a Brady obligation for the prosecution to turn over to the defense anything in their possession or control. What is in the possession or control of the prosecutor is that which is deemed in the possession or control of the state. That includes the prosecutor, others acting on the government's behalf, law enforcement officers, system-based advocates. It does not include attorneys working with survivors, right, directly representing them. But then there's this question mark about community-based advocates. And the reason it's a question mark, 9 times out of 10, community-based advocates would also have a little X. They wouldn't be governed by this, except in moments that when we haven't structured systems properly, right? And the state could make an argument that they can reach in and grab your stuff, right? This is why systems and structures of privacy, confidentiality, and privilege, when we set up things like family justice centers, things like CCRs, are so important, because if we're going to honor a survivor having control over their story, right, which is foundational, if you believe what I've already been talking about, to their move from victim to survivor to thriver, they have to keep control, right? They have to be the one that invites you in to see their closet, to see the suitcase in the closet, to see the lockbox. That matters. So we always have to be thinking downstream. What is the risk if I don't put in place sufficient protections? The risk is someone takes the survivor's story without them choosing it. And that is trauma. And then we have not done our jobs. We've set them back. And I really want us to think about this in the context, again, of the closet for a second. There might be a day when I have, you know, friends over and I'm like, hey, come in my house, right? It's messy, but come in. And then I'm like, oh my gosh, let me show you that closet, right? And come on in. And then I'm like, oh my gosh, you know what? I want to share something really private with you. And I let them into something more intense that normally is I'm the only one with the key to. And I share it with them. The next day, if that same friend came over, and we think about it this way, right? That same friend comes over and I say to them, come in my house. Would I say to them, or would I feel okay if they then went immediately to my private closet and immediately went to the lockbox and themselves opened it? Now, I invited them in yesterday. But today I'm not ready to talk about it. I don't want to. It was this moment yesterday I needed, right? Today, it is about, I still get to have the key, right? So this is all, again, I'm kind of on the theory. Casey's going to talk a little bit about how this can, how you can best structure things. But that's the way to think about it. Each day, the survivor has to have the key, or you have to have reached agreement on how many days am I letting you have the key, right? And I'll talk about what that means, right? I'm starting to hint at informed consent, right? Time limited, informed consent, that's written, all these things that are law. Also, if you just think about it as applied a little bit, you can get there. The key for all of us as service providers is not to map to threat, because that is trauma, but to map to safety, right? The idea of, I'm gonna structure everything to create safe spaces, to create ownership and agency opportunities for you, the survivor. And the way we do that is know the law, right? You do not have to be a lawyer to know the law. You have to know with whom you should partner, right? You need to get training on this. I will tell you, in this day and age of COVID, I know victims' rights, right? That is my expertise. NCVLI is filled with brilliant lawyers that I ask for help from all the time as my colleagues. But when it comes to technology and law, you know what I do? I have consistently been reaching out to NNEDV's Safety Net project to say, am I thinking about this right? Am I analyzing it right? I routinely rely on the expertise of the Confidentiality Institute to say, am I thinking about things correctly? How might I do this? Because while I know pieces of the law evolves, and the law evolves with technology and with the times. And so you need to keep learning the law. Our approach is to always default to the most protective avenue of doing things, right? The most protective way of doing things, so that what I'm doing is protecting choice. So that my survivor every day gets to decide, is he, she, or they opening the front door to me? Are they letting me in the closet? Are they letting me inside spaces in the closet? Because what our belief is around all of these rights is that survivor agency matters, not just autonomy, right? Autonomy is about choosing from those options placed in front of you, right? That's what autonomy is that I actually have control over choice, but someone put a bunch of choices in front of me. Agency, the theoretical notion of agency is that I am the architect of both the options and the choice I make amongst those options. And so in order to do this, in order to open up agency for survivors so that they are truly empowered, you have to know the law, right? And there's tons about victims' rights. There's tons about general privacy law that we aren't going to get into. But one of the fundamental tools of protecting privacy is the law of around confidentiality, right? And so this is the suitcase inside the closet, right? There are some things that I'm going to say are confidential. So beyond being just in my closet, they're confidential. They are communications or transfer of information made with the expectation of privacy. They're not accessible to the general public. There may or may not be legal requirements, right, to keep them. We're going to talk about the difference. You all on a Family Justice Center, if you're receiving VAWA or VOCA dollars or FIPSA dollars, right, we're going to talk about some of those. You actually have a legal requirement. Other times you might not have a legal requirement, but there is going to be also a professional ethical obligation, right? So confidential information is that information made with an expectation of privacy. It's not accessible, and there's legal or ethical requirements that say you must keep it confidential, which means you're not going to share it without permission, right? Examples of statutory confidentiality obligations, right? We have VOCA, we have VAWA, we have FIPSA. I want to flag that you also, all of us have to always be considering other provisions of law that may or may not facially look like they apply to us. So the Federal Educational Rights and Privacy Act, FERPA, or the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, HIPAA, you might be like, well, those apply to an educational group, or those apply to healthcare providers. They also can apply to the content of information. And a survivor has interests and rights in that information. So if a survivor shares certain medical information with me as a lawyer, you might be thinking, well, gosh, you only have to look at the legal ethics. Well, no, I actually have to think about HIPAA too. So it is both about the holder of information and about the content of the information that may create confidentiality obligations. The basic rule of confidentiality, right, if we're going to tear away the layers, is it's a legal and or professional ethical duty not to disclose information learned without informed consent. Seems straightforward, right? Oh, great. We're all about victim safety. We're all about respect for victims. I understand my ethics. I understand my funding requirements. Yes, but do we understand informed consent, right? It is very important, and I know Casey has some of the explicit language in later slides about the exact requirements, and we're going to pull directly from VAWA later, but about right time-limited written informed consent before you can share anything. Really understanding the notion of, and I went back a slide here, informed consent. As lawyers working with survivors, we draw from lots of different areas of law. And the one I think, if you go out into pop culture right now and you're thinking about understanding rights, and again, going back to that apostrophe, survivors own it, right? So there's an ownership, they own their private information. That private information might be protected by laws and ethical rules governing confidentiality. And the only way, so I share with you something, and the only way you can share it is if you get my informed consent, reasonably time-limited written informed consent. To understand that, we often look at what does the law tell us about informed consent in other situations? And I'm not going to go, you know, I'm not going to talk about consent in a sexual assault situation, right? Sexual violence notions of consent. I'm going to look at things like in criminal law, we have 100 years of case law around consent to search, right? What does it mean for someone to agree that law enforcement can access their information? What does it mean that I'm either going to voluntarily assert or voluntarily waive a particular right? That requires quite a bit of conversation with someone to really figure out, do they understand the ramifications of what could happen if they give me consent to share information? Can we get there? Of course, right? Because we honor survivor agency, right? We honor their control over their information. Is it always super easy with a survivor to ensure that they understand the ramifications of sharing information? No. But we're professionals, we can think about it. We can figure out ways to make sure the apostrophe stays intact. And that apostrophe includes, and I, you know, this is kind of an aside, I'd encourage you guys to kind of think about this later. I always feel obligated to put it in, because if for some reason confidentiality or privilege ever get breached, or are about to be breached because someone is mandating that someone try to turn things over first, please fight it. Those of us that are service providers need to fight attempts to access information. But two, we still under the law have obligations to talk to the survivor and ensure that they know what's happening and they can themselves take steps to protect their information. That's an inside. So victims must understand, in order to give informed consent, they must understand the realm of potential impacts of this. The idea that maybe they won't be able to take back certain information, the lack of control once it's released, the last bullet on the slide, the risk that defendant might have the information, right? That's hearkening back to if we're in criminal justice and it has to eventually get turned over. Survivors and those with whom we work on a daily basis, right? Oftentimes they're thinking and having to navigate today, right? How do I survive today? And as we're thinking about it, we have to be thinking about downstream, right? We have to be thinking about, once you opened that privacy closet for me and you gave me the suitcase and you opened the suitcase for me, right? You shared your key to that suitcase with me. What could happen if I then have your permission to share that further? Right? Downstream. It's our jobs to be the downstream thinkers and tell survivors what are the potential impacts. If we move on to privilege, privilege is the lockbox inside the suitcase, inside the closet, right? It is even more protected, right? Usually by statute, you can't disclose without permission, totally prohibited. generally around court or administrative proceedings, right? That's where privilege comes most into play, but we can assert it sooner and say, well, you can't get it now because you couldn't compel me to give it later. And it can only be waived by the holder of the privilege, right? That is, so again, you go back to the closet. The closet has a door, but not a lock. The suitcase inside the closet will have a lock, but often when I give you informed consent, I'm sharing a key with you to that suitcase. But inside that suitcase is a lockbox, and that one, only the survivor ever holds the key, and only they can do something with it, right? There's attorney-client, there's spousal, there's clergy-penitent. Many of us finally in this country have advocate-victim privilege. Honestly, I feel like all of us need to be tilting at that a little more aggressively on making sure that we have strong advocate privilege protections, because if you look at the privileges of three out of the five above that, doctor, patient, psychotherapist, counselor, and attorney-client, those often require financial resources and access that many of the survivors with whom we work don't have the same level as. Advocate privilege and general counselor privilege, as opposed to psychotherapist, are the ones that are most egalitarian. And so we need to be ensuring access to privilege. We often talk about access to justice, but if we don't have access to privilege in a ready fashion for survivors, we're doing a disservice, because again, this is the most protective. This is the lockbox inside the suitcase, inside the closet, right? And we, as a society, have said it's super important that in order to facilitate certain relationships, that you have privilege as this legal right not to disclose or to prevent someone from disclosing information, right? It is incredibly important that we know who has privilege so that we can protect safety, we can respect survivors. It is really important as we create community coordinated responses, multidisciplinary teams, all of these things, family justice centers, again, Casey's gonna do the as applied, that we think about who has a legal privilege, right, obligation, who has confidentiality by law or by rule, right, and then who is just gonna try and hold things private. Because again, each of those levels is different. And if we can default to the most protective, what we have done is give the survivor the most opportunity for agency. The apostrophe matters, right? And privilege, of course, there are exceptions, right? It is a challenge in law to ever keep things completely out, but privilege is the most protective when we're going from privacy, confidentiality, and privilege. So, risk points are things that we need to be paying attention to as we structure, right? Risk points around what information am I taking, what information am I recording, what information am I sharing, and then how do I talk to survivors about the downstream impacts of informed consent, right? That is a whole multi-day training, I would say, is learning how to talk with survivors about downstream impacts is challenging, right? Many of you are probably amazing at it, and I would love it if you would share with each other your ways of doing it, because, right, we have survivors come to us in crises, and we want to make sure that even in that moment, we default to the most protective, in that we default in the give up, make sure they keep the apostrophe, keep the apostrophe, they own this. How do we make sure that that stays protective? And that takes conversation. And many of us have a hard time, right? Because we're moving fast and our systems, right? Not our systems, the systems tend to make us want to move fast. But I want to flag, right, from a survivor perspective, we can do a whole lot. So, you know, NCVLI fights in courts all the time, right? So the survivor's name, right? One of the laws that exists to protect privacy is the ability to go by pseudonym. Right, in civil and criminal cases, I'll just end on this example. Right, civil and criminal cases, there are opportunities in every jurisdiction in this country to make arguments as to why you should not have to use your real name in court proceedings. Again, civil and criminal. In criminal, the U.S. Constitution does not require a name in an indictment, right? So we fight for the for survivors if they want to go by pseudonym, right? And we fight for that all the time. Even after their name has been released, we say, you know what, strip it out of documents, redact it, put things under seal, now let them go by pseudonym. That is great. And when we win those, we're happy. But was the genie a little bit out of the bottle already? Is there a possibility someone knows something that they shouldn't have? Yes. So the goal is to try not to have to put the genie back in the bottle. The goal is to always let it be the survivor that's choosing things. So there's so many questions. I just put a few because, of course, again, know my lens. I'm a victims' rights attorney that works predominantly in criminal cases. But as you're structuring things, are you ready for the subpoenas? Do you have in place all the things to know what you're going to do to respond to a subpoena, and so that you can with comfort say, if a subpoena comes for survivor's information, I know for a fact I don't have anything that I have to turn over. Do I have a process in place to notify the victim that it's going to happen? Do I have a ready response to things like, wait a second, you're part of the law enforcement or prosecution team, therefore you're subject to Brady. And I want to flag this, right? It is not always a defense lawyer that comes to you as a multidisciplinary group and says, hey, you know what, you're a part of the prosecution team. Sometimes prosecutors try to subpoena information from multidisciplinary groups. They're trying to do a job, right? It's their job. It's not, they don't have the same job as us. But the question is, are you ready? Do you know the law? Do you know privacy, privilege, and confidentiality? Are you grounded in agency, right? Survivor agency. And there are ways to structure this in family justice centers, but it takes work. And wonderfully, Casey's going to talk us through some of the tools that they have to help people think about it.
Well, thank you, Meg. That is powerful and just so right on, and a great foundation for us to kind of talk about the application of those principles in family justice centers. And you will hear a little bit in my reflections and remarks about some of the philosophical tensions that can occur and exist between the views that Meg has so articulately talked about and the philosophical approach and some of the forces that tend to come into play in collaborations or into coordinated community responses or family justice center type models. So I think it's a great way to kind of transition. I think if you think about this historically, and we go all the way back to the beginning of the early battered women's movement and the feminist movement and the fundamental sacred nature of confidentiality and privacy, as Meg talked about in the history of our country, but certainly in the history of movements of marginalized or oppressed people who were trying to gain agency and gain influence and power and control over their lives, and the need to not sacrifice their ability to have privacy and confidentiality and trying to advocate for things like access to justice. And I echo, Meg, your comment about the importance of access to privilege. I think that's a really important phrase, access to privilege. And I'll talk about that a little bit more. But when you hear everything that Meg has shared, and then you think about the journey into child advocacy centers and the turn of the 19th to the 20th century, when the child welfare movement began, a very paternalistic movement that wasn't so much interested in the confidentiality and privacy piece, a movement that did start in confidentiality, but suddenly became, we the adults are going to protect these, the children. And there are overlays in that. If you know the history of the child welfare movement in this country and the so-called orphan trains back in the late 18 and early 1900s, and this notion that people came in and took children away from their parents because they felt that they weren't properly caring for them or protecting them, you realize the potential for challenges to exist 100 years later in the very issues that we're talking about. But the child abuse movement certainly plays a role in that. The sexual assault movement, obviously grounded in many ways in privacy and confidentiality, and certainly now privilege. The domestic violence movement in general, same thing, really grounded in privacy and confidentiality and privilege, and a really strong philosophical commitment that privacy and confidentiality and privilege equals increased safety. a strong philosophical belief that most of the time that is really important to the fundamental principle of safety. And then along comes this journey into coordinated community response and then to co-located multi-agency approaches and to some of these collaborations growing out of the criminal justice system, not out of community-based agencies, to some of these collaborations being state-led or state-involved, where you've got both non-governmental folks and you've got governmental folks. You begin to see the framework or the groundwork that can create tensions and challenges in this as the Family Justice Center movement came along. Family Justice Centers are really an outgrowth of all of these movements, though. They didn't just get made up one day when we in San Diego thought, let's all get together and put agencies in the same place in 1990. That kind of work towards CCRs was happening in Duluth, Minnesota in the early 1980s. There were lots of places where child advocacy centers were developing and multidisciplinary professionals, government and non-government, were starting to come together. There were certainly sexual assault response teams into the 70s and 80s and early 90s that were looking at how do cops and advocates work together, how do confidential, privileged advocates work with law enforcement officers who are part of that Brady team that Meg made reference to, that notion that you have this legal obligation to turn over exculpatory information to a criminal defendant and the decision about who's part of that Brady team for the purposes of required disclosures to a defense attorney or a defendant in a particular situation. And all of that comes together into the 1990s as we started putting these teams together, having to figure that out. How do we share? What do we share? What can we share? When survivors are coming into that, are they coming in fully understanding what they're coming into and what the obligations are? And Meg, we don't have time to get into it, but obviously, as Meg referenced, the exceptions, you know, this whole notion of mandatory reporting that exists for some professionals is one of those very complex conversations around informed consent that we could literally spend hours on talking about. And all of that kind of culminated in the movement toward the Family Justice Center. The Family Justice Center movement did begin in agencies that came out of the criminal justice system. I was the elected city attorney of San Diego. Gail Strack was an assistant city attorney. She had been a criminal defense lawyer. She'd been a county counsel working with the child welfare system, but she too was a prosecutor. We were very close to our sexual assault agencies, to our community-based domestic violence agencies. We had a coordinated community response approach. We had a domestic violence council. We had relationships. We had built relationships of trust as well, which are obviously very important in some of this journey, because you not only need to trust each other, but you need to earn the trust of survivors and then be faithful to that trust when you earn it. Because survivors will quickly figure out whether or not you are violating their trust, violating their privacy, violating their confidentiality, violating their privilege. And so I kind of share that because this is foundational to the potential tensions that we see in the Family Justice Center world with the historic kind of understanding and the legal approach to these issues that Meg just well laid out. I put in this statement, when it comes to the process of a Family Justice Center and some of the tensions, most of the issues are not a legal divide. Everything Meg said, we agree with at Alliance for Hope International. We agree with in the Family Justice Center world. As the founders of this movement, I know Gail would say that is all accurate. But there is a philosophical dynamic that happens in a collaboration that probably is not quite as absolute default to always, always not sharing things. In collaborations, there is an approach that puts a little more emphasis on that safety can be increased with information sharing properly authorized, that offender accountability can be increased with information being shared that's been properly authorized to be shared. So there's probably a bit more of a lean, if you will, in the Family Justice Center world toward information sharing than there would be from a victim's rights perspective in the purest form. I wanted to just mention, though, being sensitive to that, in 2011, in California, we drafted the first piece of legislation in the United States on this very issue. And our goal was to honor all of those important principles around privilege and privacy and confidentiality and put it into law, but also acknowledge the incredible importance of information sharing when it is authorized. And so if you have not seen California Penal Code Section 13750, I'm not going to spend much time on it right now. It is today the only statute of its kind in the United States of America. We should have 50 states that have as comprehensive a system as what we put into California law. First, as a study bill in 2011, we did it. We used it for 2 years and had researchers evaluate it and issue a 200 plus page report to the California State Legislature before it became permanent law in 2013, including an enormous amount of both anonymous and identifiable focus group feedback from survivors, where survivors got to give feedback about how they were treated, how the provisions were applied in their lives to make sure that they still had agency, as Meg talked about earlier. So I'm not going to go through the whole law except to say first, Meg, we put in a privacy officer provision working with the Privacy Rights Institute in California. We put in a privacy officer position into California law because we wanted every family justice center in California to think about where does the buck stop on privacy? Who's responsible and ultimately accountable that the privacy of those coming to a family justice center is respected and honored? And so we literally put in a whole provision so every California center is required to designate a privacy officer. So if there's a privacy issue, they know who to bring it to, and survivors know who to bring it to. So that was one piece that was really important. The other thing that was important is we made clear that whatever's happening, even if authorized, we wanted nothing in the operation of family justice centers to damage existing privilege or the ability to have privilege. I do want to recognize Tony Atkins, who was then the Speaker of the Assembly, and former Senator Chris Keogh. Tony is now the president she's the president pro tem of the California Senate. Tony was on the San Diego City Council when we started the San Diego Family Justice Center. She is a survivor. She told her story at the very beginning of the center. She is really a national and international leader in the LGBTQI plus community. And Tony supported this because we made the commitment that we're going to define why we're getting together. We're defining how we're going to get together, what our goals are in getting together in the Family Justice Center. And we're going to make sure that we put things into law that try to protect a victim's access to justice, a victim's access to privilege, and a victim's access to services that are based on informed written consent. And so I share all of that just to say we thought a lot about this. And in fact, in California, even if privilege is waived, and a survivor authorizes the sharing of information, if there is later an attempt to come back and try to get that information from anybody, internal or external, the holder of privilege can still assert privilege. It's not waived. We created a provision in California law, much like happens in child maltreatment teams in various places around the country, where you can have a waiver of privilege, but the privilege professional still gets to assert privilege to just try to honor the victim's right to both withdraw that authorization. So I agree with you, Meg, that so often the genie does get out of the bottle and it's hard to get the genie back in the bottle. But we tried as best we could to say the genie can go back in the bottle as much as possible. Now, there's going to be unintended consequences of certain information sharing that you can't undo. But that was an important piece for us. The other thing I wanted to do is tell you, this isn't the only conversation on this. Meg made reference to the fact we've got just about an hour and a half here with probably an hour and 15 of presentations and 15 minutes of questions. But there are lots of other resources out there on this. So this is hopefully just a reminder of these issues and a spur to dive deeper. We have a series of resources available on our website, including a webinar that I did with Alicia Aiken at the Confidentiality Institute. We've also done a number of things that you see on the screen there. Lynn Rosenthal and I wrote a paper in 2005 on these very issues that is still a good document to read today. Lynn is a good friend, and most of you know she was President Obama's White House advisor on violence against women, the first ever, and came from a very consistent perspective with everything that Meg has shared. Was never a prosecutor, never was working directly in the criminal justice system, was running NNEDV at the time that we wrote that paper. So I mentioned the things that you see on the screen just to know that there's a lot to be thought about in all of this. Meg made reference to it. We're not going to get deep into VAWA, VOCA, FIPSA, FERPA, HIPAA issues on this webinar, because there's lots of acronyms that you need to be thinking about and know about. But here's the fundamental principle of Alliance for Hope International, of the founders of the Family Justice Center movement. Confidentiality and privilege should be sacred in family justice centers. Let me put a comma right there, should be sacred. They are sacred in family justice centers. And the VAWA confidentiality provision that many of you have heard about, that Meg made reference to, that applies to anybody who receives federal funds pretty much from anywhere, it is not optional. It is something that is required, that you understand privacy and confidentiality and privilege, and that you honor those things, and that information doesn't get shared unless there is informed consent, and you've got reasonably time-limited consent attached to that. This piece is crucial, it's central, and I don't want to gloss over it. There should not be a family justice center in America where they're somehow sharing information without complying with that provision at its heart. But I will say this on the balancing side of that, and from a collaborative perspective, and from a person who believes deeply in collaboration and multi-agency approaches, particularly in domestic and sexual violence. When you talk about these issues, you have to be able to say that information sharing can save lives at times as well. Jackie Campbell, who many of you know, who's a dear friend, often says, victims of domestic violence rarely overestimate the danger they're in, but they often underestimate the danger they're in. And right now, with murder suicides spiking to levels we haven't seen in more than a decade, with suicides rising, with domestic violence rising, this issue during the pandemic is as significant as it's ever been. And when you have information that you're authorized to have, and you can bring a multidisciplinary team together in that, you can save lives. When you're working collaboratively with a survivor, you can save lives. It's why we often say no victim of domestic violence should ever be walking into a courthouse to get a restraining order in domestic violence and walking out without an advocate, without support, without risk assessment, without safety planning, because we know that victims are more likely to die at the time of separation or after. And as soon as she gets that restraining order, she's in more danger than she's probably ever been in that situation. We've got to think about how we can bring a team around survivors to try to reduce domestic violence homicides and to try to increase safety. And I did add here, the best intelligence in the hands of a multidisciplinary team can increase victim safety and offender accountability. And I would say that's also only true if you're not ignoring agency. Meg and I were talking yesterday, and I was saying one of the things that offends me deeply as a former prosecutor is this notion that somehow prosecutors would force victims to testify in court against their will, subpoena them. And I did a few times early in my career, but then I began to be very disturbed by what Meg said, and that's this whole notion of agency. When you take the power away from a person to control their own story, you're literally robbing them of hope in their life. If hope is the ability to write your own future, to write your own goals, to write your own pathways to those goals, to make your own decisions about your life, if the system ends up taking away that victim's power, we're doing the exact opposite of what we should be doing if we want to honor those that are trying to navigate their way toward hope and healing in their life. I did also want to include a quote that Gail Strack said a number of years ago. She said, "People die when we don't share information. There was no other conclusion that can be drawn from the cases we have reviewed." And that's the former chair of the San Diego Fatality Review Team. That's the first Family Justice Center director in America ever. Nobody had ever done what Gail Strack did. 25 agencies under one roof that she coordinated for 5 years, 120 professionals, 120 volunteers on any given day, 240 people, 90% drop in domestic violence homicides, not a single death of a Family Justice Center client. And by the way, I could have counted on one hand in those 5 years survivors who felt that their privacy had been violated and came forward and said so, or felt that there was a breach of privilege or confidentiality and came forward and said so. And that's with focus groups with survivors, that's with anonymous feedback surveys with survivors, that's asking them. And as we go forward with the rest of my kind of comments today, I want to say, any Family Justice Center professional listening to this webinar today should be having safe, honest, and if necessary, confidential conversations with survivors if they feel that their privacy has been violated or that their confidentiality has been violated or privilege has been breached. You should know that. And if you're not asking about it, you may not find out about it. So it is absolutely crucial that part of agency is not just on the front end, it's on the back end when we make sure that survivors are in fact, their needs are being met and their agency is being honored in that process. And this slide is pretty clear. We strongly recommend as an organization that even if you don't have federal money at all, and there are some centers that don't around the United States today, we have family justice centers in 42 states and 25 countries now, and there are centers that have no federal money. You're not legally bound by VAWA provisions or FIPSA or FERPA or anything else if you don't have any federal money, but we strongly advise you to still opt in, to voluntarily follow what we're talking about when it comes to confidentiality and privilege. The other thing that's important to acknowledge in this is for everything that Meg talked about, there's a lot of misconception out there about what happens in a Family Justice Center intake. I was in a meeting just a few weeks ago where someone was describing to me how intake works in a Family Justice Center who's not part of a Family Justice Center, who said, well, you know, they're getting all this information, getting a signature from somebody and then sharing everything. That should not be happening in any Family Justice Center in America. We do advocate for a centralized intake approach, so that a survivor has to come in and only do one set of demographics, only has to do one risk assessment process, only has to do one safety planning process. But what goes in a centralized intake system, I was talking to Marnie Shields, who's a OVW advisor on these issues a few weeks ago. What goes in this system, as Marnie and I were talking about, is not very much. This should not generally be an incident-based information system. If you're keeping any information, even with permission of a survivor, you're keeping basic demographics. So if that survivor comes back, and in Family Justice Center, survivors may often come back over and over again, you don't want them to have to go through a whole intake a week after they were there the first time or 2 weeks later. You've gone over it with them from the beginning. If they want to plan to come back again and again, they may want to authorize you to keep their name and basic demographic information, to keep a record, not of what they said to anybody, but maybe who they talked to, who they met with. So that when they come back, you have a survivor not having to say, well, I talked to that woman with the blonde hair, or I talked to that African-American woman. She was really nice. She was about 5'6", but I don't know what her name was. When women or men come in crisis into a Family Justice Center, sometimes they actually appreciate being able to know who they talk to later when they come back for another visit. So that's kind of the background of this. And then just a few kind of comments in my last 10 minutes or so here, and then we'll take some questions. Here is the release and sharing of information provision in VAWA confidentiality. You can share information when the victim provides written, informed, and reasonably time-limited consent to the release of information. Or two, when a statute compels that information to be released, we reference an example of that, such as mandatory reporting, or when a court compels that information be released. But I do want to echo what Meg just said. We had a situation in a Family Justice Center in Bexar County, Texas, many years ago, where, Meg, it was just as you described. The victim came to the Family Justice Center for help. Intake was all done confidentially. The records were being held confidentially. They weren't being held under privilege, but they were being held confidentially. And fast forward, the victim's abuser ends up in the U.S. attorney's crosshairs, and they're prosecuting him for a federal offense. I don't even think it was related to domestic violence. I don't remember, but it was related to gender-based violence. The U.S. attorney called to ask for the records from the Family Justice Center, and the director of the Family Justice Center said no. So the U.S. attorney got a subpoena to subpoena the records, and the director of the Family Justice Center said no, and we supported the director of the Family Justice Center. We wanted the director to treat that as sacred information, and the victim didn't want it turned over. She was, for what her choices, her decisions, she was still with the offender at that point, and she didn't want the information turned over. And the federal prosecutor kind of said, hey, we're on the same team, right? I mean, we're all on the criminal justice team, and we're trying to stop this guy, so we want you to turn over the information. And the FJC director stood her ground, and that record was never turned over. A judge did not enforce that subpoena. So I want to say, even if a court issues a subpoena or an attorney issues a subpoena, it does not necessarily mean that you're going to turn it over. I think you still try to stand your ground and make sure that a survivor gets to make that decision whether they want to authorize it or not. And until a court orders it for you to do it, I would say we agree with that bias toward confidentiality and privilege. So let me give you a quick example. Client comes into a Family Justice Center, kind of a typical welcome at a front counter or an initial contact might be welcome to the Family Justice Center. What brings you here today? Let's say the contact is, I need a restraining order against my husband. That's the statement made. That once we know that they're in the right place, once we've welcomed them, offered them hospitality, made sure that we know that we have something that they need here, immediately you're moving into the analysis that Meg just described for you. And we're moving that survivor into a private, confidential place where they can begin to understand where they are, what the rules are, what the information is. And I will say, Meg, I agree with you that if there's a mistake made in family justice centers today, it's not an adequate conversation around informed consent. And that can happen in other agencies. I felt like when I ran a domestic violence shelter in San Diego many years ago, I felt like even there, when women were in crisis coming into the shelter, when we were talking about certain things, and then we were talking about information they might want to share, because we were so focused on the crisis, sometimes we'd forget the depth and the longevity of that conversation about unintended consequences, about information being shared down the road, even if there's no consequence for sharing it now. And so I think that conversation is really important in this. And then the question becomes, even if there is some dialogue, if there's going to be a cloud-based system or some information kept, what is that information kept? And I encourage you to lean back on the things that Meg raised about what gets kept, because a survivor may say something that they don't actually want to end up being stored anywhere, and making sure they're clear on what is getting stored and what isn't getting stored is very important. The danger assessment, we use the danger assessment tool in so many family justice centers. This issue comes up a lot, because if the danger assessment tool were to be released to law enforcement, we know that a victim, let's say, is a 29 on the danger assessment, she's in extreme danger, and we asked, do you want us to share that with the detective working your case if there's a criminal case going on at a family justice center? And we better understand and help her understand the consequences of that, because if I turn over a danger assessment, a full danger assessment, I'm also turning over whether she's had suicidal ideation or not. I'm also maybe turning over information about drug or alcohol use, and she may not want that information turned over, and we need to make sure that if something gets turned over, that she fully understands those consequences of it. And otherwise, we keep that sacred. And I do believe that Family Justice Center should be doing intake under privilege, Meg, just like you kind of referenced. That the person that survivor is talking to should ideally be a holder of privilege, because privilege is, in Meg's words, the lockbox inside the suitcase inside the closet. And if that's the way a survivor gets to share information initially while seeking help at a family justice center, under privilege, we're going to be in a much better position to protect that information and let the survivor control where it gets shared, how it gets shared, and who it gets shared with. So after that warm welcome and a survivor coming in, and we make sure they're in the right place, and maybe they fill out demographics initially. In some centers they do, in other centers they're just brought into a safe place, and they even do the demographics in a safe place. In San Diego, we started out with kind of a one-page form that was just demographics, so that it could be, once authorized, she could have a written reason to say, you can share my demographics with a navigator or someone that's going to know a little bit about me before I talk to them. That was kind of how it worked. And then once they get into the center, as we said, they would go into first a welcoming place. We usually called it the dining room or the kitchen. And then after that, they would end up sitting down with somebody in a confidential setting. In some centers today, that is under privilege, as I said, probably the majority of centers. And I will say, Meg's comment is interesting about the history of all this, because in centers that are DA-led or centers that are police-led, and there are some of those across America, there probably is less focus on these issues of privilege and confidentiality and privacy than in centers that are led by community-based agencies. And the trend today in family justice centers is the majority of family justice centers starting up are being led by community-based sexual assault DV agencies that have that grounded foundation in confidentiality, privacy, and privilege. And now they're adding partners, but they're adding it with that foundation. And I will say that I think because of the soul of those agencies, I think that is a model that can often be much more effective in honoring agency and not having to deal with as many of these tensions about information sharing and confidentiality. But the goal is confidentiality at a minimum. The goal is privilege in every situation, if possible, for the sharing of information, and then the coordination of services. And one of the things I will mention, and Meg, I don't know if you're game to just comment on this right now, but in the Family Justice Center movement over the last 15 years, we have seen hypothetical questions become a very effective way for a multi-agency team to work. So if a survivor comes in and they're talking to somebody and they say, well, I'd like to know what would happen if I said, you know, if this detective had this information, dot, dot, dot. And maybe the navigator doesn't know exactly what would happen. And we have found that without any disclosure of any identifying information, that hypothetical questions are often a great way. A navigator can go talk to a detective and say, hey, if I had a situation like this, tell me about how you'd handle that. Do you teach on that at all, or talk about hypotheticals at all in the work that you've done around privacy?
Yeah, absolutely agree, Casey, that kind of both on the front end and then in the kind of in the moment they can work, right? At the front end, it's scenario-based training. So anyone who's going to co-locate or who's going to collaborate, doing scenario-based trainings about what if this information was shared, let's do a hypothetical, I shared this information, where might it go, is really useful training at the front end in order to both understand what might happen, but also understand the lens through which each partner sees the law, right? Because we all might have different interpretations of law, and knowing that at the front end helps. And then in the moment, doing some sort of hypothetical, like, hey, what would happen with information about, so-and-so talked to me about a kiddo, and I'm not a mandatory reporter, you know, what would you do with the information? And confirming their understanding of their own mandatory reporting obligation, super useful, you know, as an example. But, you know, those are very useful ways to figure out what might happen for an individual survivor, but also I would say not to wait until you have a real survivor, but to do scenario-based trainings. And, you know, I'm good. Folks in my office know that I am a naysayer to a certain degree. I always want scenario-based trainings where we are looking at what's the worst case scenario so that we can plan for that. That's what we plan for. We plan for the example you gave, Casey, where a U.S. attorney is trying to get information, a prosecutor is trying to get information. Do we have the systems in place? So I completely agree with you that in the moment it's useful, and I would encourage front-end training.
That's good. And then just to emphasize this notion of survivor feedback, family justice centers push hard to create these voices committees where survivors get to have input about policies and procedures and approaches. Nobody should be doing an intake process and putting it in writing in a family justice center without sitting down with their voices committee and listening to survivors about their thoughts and concerns and how they think should be happening and what they think feedback can and should look like. So this feedback loop has been so important in centers. And when we see centers that aren't what I would call as trauma-informed or hope-centered, they're not doing this as much. A private little anonymous comment box is not feedback or dialogue with survivors. That is one avenue, but it's got to be much more significant than that. And so when we mocked up these first pictures, and that's not a real survivor in that picture, that's actually a volunteer at the San Diego Family Justice Center. But when we mocked up these pictures of the importance of this, we picked this picture intentionally because that's a navigator at the San Diego Family Justice Center modeling not just an exit survey in some written document, but sitting down with a survivor after they've talked to a legal aid attorney, after they've interacted with a mental health professional or whoever else they've asked to see at a family justice center, and then says, how did we do? Did you get your needs met today? Are there other things that you wanted to do that didn't happen? What else can we do to help? That personal dialogue piece is important. And then, and there are issues that get implicated in confidentiality, privacy, safety around follow-up, but this importance of getting permission to follow up, making sure that follow-up is safe. We have found across America that building a relationship with survivors is crucial in this. And if I say to Meg, next week, Meg, let's have dinner, we're not going to have dinner because Meg is in Oregon and I'm in Idaho and we're not going to have dinner. But if I say, hey, in July, I'm going to be in Oregon, Meg, and I'll be in Portland and I'd love to have dinner. And she says, okay, I'd like to have dinner. And I say, how about Thursday night at 7 o'clock and we'll connect there. We're more likely to have dinner because we've had follow-up, we've had personal conversation, we've both agreed to this. And that piece of this journey through confidentiality has to be important in this, to make sure that it's safe for us to follow up with survivors, but to make sure that we really are following up. So I'm going to stop there. We're at 12:16. We have the opportunity to have some additional dialogue and comments and questions. And Meg, we'll just dive into the questions because we've got quite a lot of them. And if you'd like to add a question, you can type this in to the question box on the webinar platform. But I'll give you a couple. Let's see, a lot of them around the whole kind of information sharing concept. This question is, there's a couple of questions like this. How does information shared with an advocate become privileged, or what makes it privileged? You want to take that one?
Sure. And it's a great question. And this is why front end work matters. So privilege is a statutory or can be rule-based creation, meaning it's in law. So you have to go look in your individual jurisdiction's law to figure out who falls under various privileges. There are the ones I had on the screen, you know, there's attorney privileges, there's mental health provider privileges. There are advocate privileges. And so the starting point is go look in your law and see who qualifies for a privilege under your law. And then the second piece, how strong is that privilege? Because every privilege has different exceptions. And then what you want to do is staff, hopefully, the ideal, as Casey noted, and NCVLI would echo this, you staff intake, you staff navigation with the strongest privilege. And there are things called joint privilege in law also, where you can, if you're doing certain collaborations, you can have joint privilege. That's a pretty complex analysis though. But so the starting point is go pull the law. And if you need help with that, obviously Alliance for Hope can provide some technical assistance, but NCVLI can provide technical assistance. The other folks that I told you we rely on provide technical assistance on these things, Confidentiality Institute, NNADV, Victims' Rights Law Center. There's lots of groups focused on privacy, privilege, and understanding what it means in each jurisdiction. So look at your own law. If you need help analyzing it, reach out for assistance.
That's good. there's a number of questions that have come in about system-based advocates, and I'll just summarize them by saying, the questions essentially are, how do we protect a victim's information from being turned over to the defense if we're a system-based advocate in a police department or a district attorney's office? And I will just say, for the short answer, it is very difficult for you to do that. If you are part of the evidence chain, you can certainly take a position as best you can of confidentiality, but you're not. You don't have privilege with that victim if you're part of the what's called the Brady team. And if you are required in your job to turn over information, that becomes a consent process and an information process to let survivors know that what they tell you is not confidential information. And I don't know, Meg, if you want to comment about that, but if you're a system-based advocate, generally speaking, you need to partner with a community-based advocate that has privilege, that can have those conversations with the victim and is not legally required to turn over that information to the prosecution.
I totally agree, Casey. This is one of those moments where we each serve a role, right? Like none of us alone can serve a survivor. So if someone's navigating criminal justice, it is phenomenal that there is a system-based advocate that exists. And we need that survivor to also have someone who is outside of the system to ensure that there is strong confidentiality and hopefully privilege. Because if you are under the umbrella of Brady, your information will be turned over. Now, two caveats on that, or three really. The first is, to echo Casey, this comes down to survivors should know at the outset whether you have privilege or confidentiality or where you land in that. They should understand and choose, right? So they need to know, same way we talk about mandatory reporting. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, can we still have systems in place that minimize the information, even if you are a system-based actor, that goes to the defense? Yes, right? There are things called work products. So if you're under and what you're actually doing is work product, that might be protected under the law. Can we, right from the get-go, have a survivor's name protected through pseudonym? Potentially, right? Their address, their telephone number. Can we have systems in place that are authorized by law for redaction, for different iterations of your notes, for different information of sharing? Yes. And so the third caveat of all of this is, please get training around this. Understand what your local district attorney thinks Brady means, because again, unfortunately, there's a whole lot of differentiation in the interpretations. Have trainings between advocates, law enforcement, prosecution, so that there is a system-wide understanding in this county, under this umbrella, what do we mean? So there are no surprises, so we can tell survivors accurately at the front end. But punchline, if you are a system-based advocate, you need to assume information will be turned over and have a partner that has the opposite assumption, right? Opposite operational law.
Good. There's a number of questions about informed consent. Does informed consent have to be written, especially if the advocacy work is done primarily through phone outreach? You want to take that one first?
So I know OVW in this time of COVID is analyzing all of the realities of how do we get written consent, and again, Safety Net Project and technology groups are working on this too. The law says written, right? The law is the law. And so you need to be, and the governing aspects of it apply to us right now. So we need to be finding ways of abiding by it and through our reasonable best efforts. If there's literally no way to get it in the moment, potentially it doesn't have to be written because you'd have a good faith exception to the law, but the law says written. And so we all need to be figuring out, particularly in the time of COVID and technology, what constitutes a writing and what constitutes a signature, while keeping protection and safety in mind. Because if you're not in person with someone, you do not know what their environment is that might be resulting in signature and consent. So I believe, Casey, maybe you can correct me, but I believe that OVW was issuing various technical assistance providers of OVW are providing responses to this as we move through COVID.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that are being discussed about that. I will say that family justice centers have been, if a victim has access to the internet and it's not just a phone call, quite a number of our centers are using EverSign. It is not a profile that we have examined greatly, but it's much less expensive than DocuSign, which is the online signing program that they use for real estate transactions now and bank transactions and so forth. EverSign is relatively inexpensive, and we have found that there is a way if a victim has access to the internet. Now, if the victim doesn't have access to the internet, we've had a lot of conversations about how you can cultivate informed consent in that, or do your best to still have the conversation. If you want me to share something, can you take a picture of your signature saying, I've been informed of this, and send it to me. If she's got access to a smartphone, there's lots of creative ways, but at the end of the day, I'm with Meg, it's legally required. Meg, there's just a lot of questions. We'll try to get to as many as we can. There's some questions about if victims' rights attorneys are working in a multidisciplinary sexual assault or domestic violence agency, is there any issue with legal and non-legal staff using the same case management system where all users can view all data for all cases? Does that create an issue for attorney-client privilege? I'll take a shot at that first. So that makes me incredibly twitchy. So if there is a system in place where everybody has access to everything, that should not be happening. That is fraught with peril from a family justice center standpoint. And you can't even waive that. You couldn't create a waiver that would allow you to say everybody gets to see everything. It wouldn't be legal or ethical in any way, shape, or form for most professionals.
Yeah, twitchy is an understatement. Absolutely. My records as a lawyer cannot be seen out by anyone other than someone on my immediate legal team if I'm going to maintain privilege. So that should not happen. And if that is happening where there is broad access to records, please A, stop it, and B, get some technical assistance on how to structure things.
And we're more than happy. We've got a whole toolkit on intake in family justice centers, and we're more than happy to provide technical assistance around that. The most that should probably ever be accessible to community partners from an intake system in a family justice center might be basic demographic information if the survivor has authorized all the partners to see that, or maybe who the survivor is seeing if the survivor through informed consent and written consent has authorized partners to know that they're seeing five different agencies. Incident-based information, not a chance in the world that should be accessible to everybody. And whoever is gathering that incident-based information, if it's going into a case management system, it should be held, as Meg said, in the lockbox inside the suitcase inside the closet. We'll try to grab a few more here. Go ahead.
Just a quick follow-up. Even with the seemingly basic demographic information, I just challenge everyone to please be really reflective of what that is and what are the downstream aspects. It may be totally fine and you can have the conversation with the survivor and they may give informed consent. There may also be things where the way you've structured your collaboration, the service provider, if you're going to keep which service provider did they access, and that stays in the database and then other people know it, maybe that discloses something that the survivor doesn't want. So they actually went to a mental health provider in your agency. Mm-hmm. Maybe they don't understand that discloses something in and of itself because it's the only, let's say it's the only psychiatrist. I'll go far, right? There aren't psychiatrists in many, but right, there is prescribing. They have authority to prescribe. Does that disclose something that might not? It's always about being a critical and an analyst of what information is there and what information is shared, and then having that conversation with the survivor. But general access, absolutely no go.
I'll grab a couple of these. There's an example given here from one of the attendees about what I would say is misconduct in the handling of information at a family justice center. Does the perpetrator, the defendant in a criminal assault case, strangulation case, have a right to receive information and access information about the domestic violence victim who is living in a shelter at a family justice center? The domestic violence victim shared what she thought was confidential information with a domestic violence advocate. The advocate shared private confidential information about the DV victim during counseling sessions with administrative staff. So that's improper. That should not be happening. I totally understand how that can happen, especially sharing it with administrative staff when you're all working together in a collaborative team. And so this was going on. I saw that in, at times in a shelter where advocates were talking to each other about something without having made sure that they had permission from a client in the shelter to share that information with people that were outside the privilege. And that should not have been happening either. So that could happen in a CCR, in a family justice center, in a community-based DVSA agency. That should not be happening. Any comments on that, Meg?
No, just totally agree.
Okay. There's a lot of others here. Here's one on the other side, Meg. This is coming, I think, from law enforcement. How do we get, and they name an agency by name, how do we get this agency to share information for victim safety to assist law enforcement when investigating a crime, for example, missing persons? So I'll just take a first shot at that. I've been doing this work for 35 years. I've never seen bigger fights than when law enforcement wants to get information from a confidential community-based agency. Is this victim in your shelter? We can't confirm or deny. Well, wait a minute, I dropped her off here last night. I know she's here. We can't confirm or deny, but if you'd like to leave a message, if we do have access, we'll certainly get her a message. No, I need to talk to her right now. I've watched that play itself out over and over. My two comments: one, long before you start a coordinated community response, long before you start a family justice center, those are the kind of hypothetical case scenarios that Meg's talking about working through, because legal obligations are totally separate in those different agencies. And number two, if you try to use the power of the state to overcome the agency of an organization, that is the decision-making organization or the decision-making individual, the repercussions of that can so re-traumatize and so re-victimize when you think you're doing the right thing. You got to plan for it beforehand, and we've got to make sure that everybody understands that we do not all play the same role, even when it comes to victim safety.
I will echo that. I think all of us need to take a deep breath and be okay as we breathe out with that a survivor's control over their information is important, and that not sharing information is okay. Does sharing information, can it save lives? Yes. Can sharing information also hurt a survivor and undermine their faith in self and community? Mm-hmm. Yes. And so take a deep breath and be okay with not sharing information sometimes, and ask, and putting the apostrophe back in the equation for the survivor, and have these conversations where I think, you know, from a law enforcement perspective, completely understand and respect their approach and their role. But it comes down to seeing different aspects of the whole, right? We're all seeing pieces of the equation. And if we do some cross training at the front end and understand each other's roles, we can together serve survivors and understand differentiation of role.
Good. I know we're out of time, but we're going to take about 3 or 4 more minutes before we wrap up. I'm sorry we won't get to all of these questions, but here's one. Is it possible to share the score only of the danger assessment, if with permission and if authorized, as opposed to sharing the details? That's a really interesting one. We've talked a lot about that in family justice centers. My concern would be that you can a survivor can authorize a detective to know you're a 29 or something. There could be later an effort by a defense attorney to say, if the detective now uses that and says, I found out from the family justice center she was a 29 in the danger assessment. If I'm a criminal defense lawyer, I'm going to say, I want that danger assessment. That score was provided, but I don't know what the basis for the score is. I want that. And it could put you in a situation where you'd have to fight about it, and obviously not, you know, disclose that unless you're ordered to. There are other ways that you could do that, however. If you had a situation where somebody scored a 29 without disclosing either the score or the danger assessment, you could ask for permission to say, this victim is in extreme danger, to the detective. That's all. Just, this victim is, in my opinion, in extreme danger. And based on the relationships that you have and the planning and the training that you've done, that detective knows that extreme danger is something really important. and that they need to pay particular attention to this case. So I think you could try to authorize just the score, but in the process of informed consent, I think you need to be careful, because if I was a criminal defense lawyer, I'd argue that you had disclosed something that I now need to know the basis for, and we'd fight about that in court. And if that did become a fight in court, my strong encouragement is Family Justice Center, fight disclosure, prosecutor, fight disclosure. Try to protect the sanctity of that communication. In the California law, we addressed this and said, if information is shared for the purposes of victim safety, it does not have to be disclosed. It's in the statute. So we protected it statutorily. So we'd win that argument in California. But in other places, I don't know if you'd win it or not.
I just agree with everything you said, and I want to add, and when these fights are happening, be sure the victim knows they're happening and that he, she, or they has access to a lawyer to independently fight them themselves also, because you should be fighting them, prosecution should be fighting them, but the survivor has the apostrophe. They need a victim's rights lawyer. They need to be fighting them if that's their choice.
There's a couple of, we don't have time for all of these, Meg, but there's a number of comments about situations where you might get a judge in family court trying to get victim information turned over from a family justice center. I say fight. I say the civil legal attorney should be fighting to protect the information in the center. The prosecutor should be fighting. Everybody should be fighting. Unless there is an authorization for that information to be provided. And that is not Brady material for the purposes of family court. This is, the criminal court system has very different rules about this for disclosure of confidential information than a family court does.
It does. And I will add that victims' rights, which while facially they look like may only attach in criminal cases, they have been and can successfully be argued in non-criminal cases to extend. So if you have a right to refuse discovery, if you have a right to privacy, if you have a right to protection under your victims' rights statutes, those are at play in a family court proceeding as well. So fight, yes.
We're out of time, but I will just finish with one here, because this is real. Here it is. What happens if we have a victim in the center and law enforcement tells us that the victim has a warrant for her arrest? Do we have to turn her in? Let me take a shot at that first. So this echoes what Meg said earlier. There should be clear policies and procedures on this long before you end up in that situation in a family justice center. We had to address these early on in the San Diego Family Justice Center. Gail addressed it very clearly. We were not going to arrest victims in family justice centers. But if a victim said, you know, I've got a traffic warrant out for my arrest, or I've got a shoplifting warrant, we would do everything we could to get that warrant cleared so that the victim doesn't end up in jail on a traffic stop or anything else. And if a warrant is an order to a law enforcement officer, but law enforcement officers still have discretion in their job. They have the ability to say, this is our procedure and policy. And my goal would be train on this, have clear policies on it. The preference in every family justice center is get those warrants recalled. Right now, very few people are being served warrants or arrested on warrants for most things. It would be a terrible disservice if victims of domestic violence are ending up getting arrested when they're coming forward for help. Our goal should be to get those warrants withdrawn, get a date set in court, get her a lawyer to work it out. But law enforcement, please don't miss the forest for the trees. The goal here is to create a hope-centered, trauma-informed environment where people can get help. It is not simply to put blinders on and serve some kind of a warrant for something. I mean, it would certainly matter to me what the crime was. If it was a murder warrant, that might be different to me than a traffic warrant. And if that survivor is currently in a safe place and they're a threat to no one in the center, really, what purpose does it serve to serve something if we can in fact get it addressed? I don't know, Meg, if you have any comments on that one, but that one kind of gets me going too.
No comments other than for me, there's no difference in those two warrants because it's a safe place. But yeah, I agree with that.
I think that's fair. And I think that probably is a good place for us to wrap up. I know we've got other questions and I'm sorry that we're not gonna be able to get to them all. But this is an hour and a half, actually it's an hour and 37 minutes, but it's an hour and a half of conversation about this. I wanna thank Meg, thank you for framing this. Thank you for the dialogue. This is complicated and this deserves hours and hours and hours. It deserves specialized training. It deserves dialogue. It deserves scenarios. It deserves relationship building so that we respect and understand different roles. If you're going to bring in government and non-government people, when it works well, it can be incredibly powerful. And when it doesn't work well, it can rob people of the very hope that their abusers are robbing them of by taking away their agency and their ability to control their story. We say at the Alliance, we're all writing our own hope story in life every day, our goals, our pathways. When people get robbed of their ability to write their own story, we've got to do everything we can to change that. Whether that robbery is happening at the hands of an abusive partner, or that robbery is happening at the hands of the criminal or civil justice system, or even a collaboration that is not respecting and honoring their ability to try to tell their own story and to try to make their own story and set their own goals. So thank you all for joining us. Meg, thank you. Any closing comment?
Thank you to you and everyone doing this work.
Meg is a great resource to all of you. There's the information on NCVLI.org, their website, and you can access technical assistance there. We've made reference to others that have done technical assistance around this. We are happy to be part of any of that as well. At the Family Justice Center Alliance, our program at Alliance for Hope, there's Meg's contact information. There's mine. In these times of incredible uncertainty and these times where we're all experiencing collective trauma, thank you to all of you for the work you do every day, even battling your own journey through having hope over your life and being able to set goals that you can control in the midst of things you cannot control. Let's do our best to encourage and support each other and find ways to increase safety for victims and increase accountability for those who are still choosing to use violence with others in their life in this most vulnerable of times for people in need. Blessings on all of you. Thanks for joining us today.